Thanks for the invitation. So yes, as Amin said, my main topic is on brain-computer interfaces, and I also had the chance to do a wonderful internship in Switzerland about spinal cord neurostimulation. Actually, today, as you told me that I could do what I wanted, I chose to give like a panorama of the neurotechnologies and to profit of this opportunity to discuss with you of the usability of the different devices and to have your feedback of the different neurotechnologies that exist. But if you have some questions, more specifically on brain-computer interfaces or of the neurostimulation of the spinal cord, I will be very pleased to answer your question. So Yves presented you the brain and the nervous system and its complexity. My part is more the mirror part, how the technology and the neurotechnology try to help people who have a lesion of this nervous system. So it's still difficult to have a consensual definition of the neurotechnology. I made this one. It's any technical and computational tool that measure and analyze chemical and electrical signals in the nervous system to allow some control and or to interact directly with the nervous system to change its activity. So to give you some example, there are different strategies to build a neurotechnology. Most of these tools are used for research, but you have some tools that aim to improve the nervous system. Here, after a stroke, for example, you will try to decode the intention of the motion from a patient. He tried to move his paralyzed limb, but usually he cannot move. And there is some, an exoskeleton that will activate each time the device is detecting mental activity. So it's interesting for patients who do not have any kind of motricity. Then they can still train something. They can train their mental activity and hoping for recovering the rest. So this is one example. Another strategy is to restore the part that is injured, like a future project that will rise in Switzerland is to implant the brain in a spinal cord injured person and to stimulate the spinal cord below the lesion. So then you shortcut the lesion and you have the command and it goes directly to the spinal cord. So it's another strategy. And another one that is quite used in research, at least, is to replace totally, instead of using your own limb, you use an external device. Now you can have either robotic device, robotic arms, or also the mainstream interface like an app on your phone or on your computer. Here you have two patients that have an implanted device here, and their brain activity is decoded and they control these devices only in the lab at the moment. And you can have also some strategies that aim to enhance the cognitive abilities of people, the students, or anyone who wants to improve his cognitive abilities. So I decided to do this presentation because finally, after several years in this field, I realize it's quite complicated for the general audience to know what is usable today or not. If you have a spinal cord injury, maybe all your friends send you this kind of media coverage saying, oh, look at this, it's very, very interesting. And you are quite an expert, so you know sometimes, not always, what to do with that. But for a lot of people, it's complicated to know if it's already usable or not. So the aim of this presentation is to give you some help to have a better knowledge about that. So in the last year, I selected two breakthrough devices that had a large media coverage. Maybe you know this one. It's a French one. That's CleanAttack One. So this patient has a spinal cord injury, it's a tetraplegia, incomplete. He has a device in his brain and he's controlling a four-limb exoskeleton for the first time. And this is last week, it's very recent, so Vance, you know it, I see. Elon Musk, who is the CEO of Neuralink, and also maybe you know him better for the Tesla company and the SpaceX company, but he also want to target the brain now. And he presented the chip that they want to implant in the brain. And he presented this slide telling everyone that they aim to cure memory loss, paralysis, brain damage, addiction, insomnia, anxiety, like every neurological disease. And for the general audience, this sometimes seems plausible, whereas if you have some neuroscience knowledge, you know that this is really difficult to cure and really difficult to target with only one small chip. So what are the neurotechnology in real life at the moment? One device was very successful, it's the cochlear implant. Probably because it's modeling the ear is something that is quite easy to do. You transform some sound in a psychoacoustic signal, and after you have the electrical signal that is sent. So it's like a transduction. It's really easy to do. You also have magnetic stimulation to treat severe depression that is used at hospital when the other treatment failed. So these both examples are used in routine. For motor impairment, you have something that is quite useful also. It's the deep brain stimulation. In Parkinson's disease, you have two electrodes near to the central part of the brain, and that aim with the stimulation to reduce the tremor and also the dyskinesia that really are really harmful for the patient with Parkinson. But for the other neurological injury, you do not have really neurotechnology. It's the beginning of some exoskeleton that try to use bioelectric signal, but it's really the beginning. They are not still here already there in rehab, and I guess not here in ants. So we really have a few devices available. So it's difficult to understand why there is such a discrepancy between media coverage and the life of a person with a disability. Because when you discuss with journalists and people, they say, everything improve and it should be straightforward. Now we have that, it will function. So I will try to develop why there is this discrepancy. I will use three axes. First, I will try to highlight that there is some overconfidence in the inevitability of technological advances. There is a problem of poor knowledge of the state of the art of assistive device and of disability also. And more generally, people underestimate the complexity of the nervous system and the lack of fundamental neuroscience that we need now. So just to illustrate the bias you have in forecasting the future in neurotechnology, if I ask you the future of drugs, you won't have a lot of ideas. You will invent a new pills, but with nanotechnology, I don't know what's inside, but you won't imagine a lot of technological things. For the future of neurotechnology, you already have in mind a lot of science fiction thing, mainly dystopia. I have trouble to find something more sympathetic. But you already imagine artificial intelligence working like our own brain. You imagine, I heard Elon Musk saying the spinal cord is like a wire, so you just have to change the wire to repair it, which is nonsense, knowing the complexity of the spinal cord and all the loop that Eve showed you before. But in the general audience, this works because, yeah, the spinal cord, it looks like nothing and easy to repair. So you have this bias, imagining everything is almost ready. It's just you wait, your smartphone improves, so this will improve until that point. But actually, technological advances do not always bring functional improvement. And I will use here an example that I know the best. It's for brain-computer interfaces, but probably you will have in mind other example. For brain-computer interfaces, since more than 20 years, it's a person with a locked-in syndrome, a person who could only move his eyes, was implanted to control a cursor on a computer, thanks to a chip in his brain. After, there was the possibility in 2005 to use an artificial hand. It's Matt Nagel here. So he has the possibility to use an artificial hand, and also they try to test different things. They use also a computer cursor, lights and TV, like daily life activities. It was 15 years ago. More recently, but still 7 years ago, it was possible to control a robotic arm to drink. This patient, here I do not have the video, but she has a big smile because she can drink by her own after many trials and a lot of rehabilitation. And only in the lab you can see there is this chip, there is the engineer behind, and there is also a lot of computers. So at this period it was still very heavy and confined in a lab. And after, they try a different region of the brain, so the part that is more implicated in attention, as Yves presented you before, there are a succession of steps, and so they try the step before the programmation directly, but with no exceptional improvement.
Excuse me, but if I'm not mistaken here, we only have technological improvements. I mean, it's just...
Yeah, at the moment. Yeah, at the moment. So at this moment, yeah, I was presenting this slide saying after we just miss the part where we remove the chip, we remove the cables, and we can circulate and be at home. I fully agree. At this moment, I was presenting this like there is only progress. After they decided, it's a technological thing, but they decided to, in order to improve the duration of the electrode and to improve this usability, they decided to go not inside the brain, but on the surface, which is better because this electrode, they last only several months, so it's dangerous to implant you only for several months, and it's nonsense. So there was this progress for several year duration, they hope. And last year, there was this study that, for me, was both exciting and disappointing. But it was exciting on the hardware, because the novelty, it's the first fully implanted electrode. So, yeah, you are free, you can circulate. They embedded the computational part in the exoskeleton, so you could imagine maybe some activity outside. There were 8 commands at the same time, which is the first time. Usually it was really reduced, and this time you will see there are different strategies, but 8 commands at the first time, it's quite high. And four lamps exoskeleton are also exceptional, because before you saw only one robotic arm or hand. But functionally, the result was that the choice to link this implant with this exoskeleton led to something quite absurd, because the training was done in the lab with the exoskeleton, and very raw and very short, because it was exhausting for the patient. So he had the possibility to train at home, but with a small game on his screen, but not with a directly motor task. And he controlled the lower limb. But the thing is, the electrode is on the part that is the representation of the arms only, on the cortex. So the limb, the lower limb, they are inside between the two hemispheres. And so the signal is quite bad for that. So the choice was to have on-off program, walk or not walk. This is something you can do by speaking or with only a button or a joystick.
So an anecdote on this operation, Professor Benavid told me that the very first one they put in, they have a temperature regulator to control safety in case it overheats.
The very first time?
The very first time. Right. And in fact, when they put it in and then closed it up, they found that it didn't work.
Yeah, for the first patient,
exactly,
you're
first
right.
Patient.
I will talk about that.
Okay, exactly.
Yeah, indeed, yeah.
Yeah, and they had to fix that. And that was a challenge for them, but it was a curious phenomenon.
I imagine that is a point.
And also, you mentioned something very interesting, which is that we use very complicated stuff, like implanting electrodes, but then sometimes it's not better than just a voice command or
exactly.
It's just on off.
That's the point here. That's why I was really disappointed by this study. But still, it's an impressive study. And but they have a dozen of millions of euros, and we have the right, I think, to ask what it is usable for, and also for the, I don't know if it's the perennity of the field. I think the more you have usable devices, the more you can ask for more money also. So this was strange for me, and for the upper limb also, it's not really usable, because it was only the pointing task without the grasping. So now they are working, to be honest, and they are working now on the grasping, and there will be improvement on this part. But it's pointing is not very useful in daily life for functional point of view, except maybe to communicate. So this is disappointing, especially when you know that the patient could monitor his wheelchair with his joystick, because he has still a little movement of his hand. So a commentary that arises that I found very interesting is it was in The Lancet with the big publication of Ali Mouri Benabid. And this commentary is a full limb exoskeleton a step in the wrong direction? And I think it's a really relevant question. This guy is Tom Shakespeare. He presents himself as a social scientist and bioethicist, an academic who writes and talks and research mainly about disability. Actually, he is also in the wheelchair, so he knows this topic very well. And he talks also about ethical issues around prenatal genetic testing and assisted end of life. So he covers a wide range of topics, but he's not a specialist of neurotechnology. Here, he saw mainly the social part and the usability part. We have a very small discussion by mail about that, and his part is mainly what should be the direction of this kind of technology. And the first thing he said in this short paper is that the cost constraint of this high-tech option are never going to be available to most people in the world with spinal cord injury. At the moment, 15% of the population only can afford the assistive device when it's so. Yes, it's a point. People with tetraplegia do already have usable solutions. I will discuss this point also after, and more usable than this one. Also, a new paralyzed patient does indeed dream of walking again. A person who has adapted their situation might have other priorities. Bladder, bowel management, pain control, avoidance of pressure shocks. I guess, yeah. It's obvious, but it's good to remind this. And he criticized the dominant medical mindset that seems always to have wanted to make the paralyzed people walk. And he criticized also the terms such as confined to wheelchair or wheelchair bound, which is indeed quite ironic because if you think of it, if you are confined in the wheelchair that allow you to go outside and do your life, what are you in this exoskeleton in one room, holded by a cable? So you are more confined in this exoskeleton, actually, at the moment. So the question is a question of the direction. Do we want to do something that is like ableism, like to do things exactly like people who are able, who do not have any disability, like walking like them or have such objective, or do we want to go in the direction that as first as we can, we want something usable and because we know that this is the most useful for the quality of life. And this discussion should be done also with the end user, the patient, but also the clinician and the people with the expertise. Something that probably plays a role in this study is that there is no rehabilitation professional, at least in the authors, the main authors. It's more like engineers and neurosurgeons. So maybe the next step will be to include more patients. There is not also the opinion of the user. It's also, I'm very happy, but we don't know exactly what he thinks for the future will be the most useful, etc. And Tom Shakespeare said that we would like to have the opinion of the user. It's mandatory for the next study. At the same time, other studies with more added value in terms of functionality receive less attention, so less funding, and etc. For example, this study that was published almost at the same time in October last year, it was an implant that was implanted from, I don't remember exactly, but for more than a year. I think it was 3 years. And in people with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, you know, it's this neurodegenerative disease where the motor system degrades over time, and at the end, you can communicate only by the eyes, and after even that, disappear. So it's very complicated, and they implanted this patient, and the more the disease progresses, the more this device became useful. And the patient who learned to control it before could use it at the end. They tried to use it at an alarm sending, because it's very an emerging needs for this patient that cannot be done by other device, because the eye tracker, if it's not well placed, you cannot use it. They do not control their hands, so there is almost no other option. So this study, in terms of usability, it's relevant. Maybe we could discuss from now to implant some of these patients to help them. Already the benefits risk balance is good for them. I didn't talk about the risk of the surgery, but before there were two implants of 5 centimeters in your brain, and knowing that the brain is spared in spinal cord injury, it's questionable to risk some injury for no benefits. So this also should be carefully discussed. And at the same time, as you said, mainstream technologies and namely human-machine interfaces progress faster, rendering some neurotechnologies useless before they can access the market. And it's the case, for example, for automatic speech recognition. In Tetrapedia, now you can command with your voice, you can command your iPhone, your domotic, a lot of devices that was impossible to access before, and without needing an implant in your brain. So already brain-computer interface have a very limited, at the moment, application. It's the same for eye tracking. And this was thanks to advances in artificial intelligence, namely deep learning and machine learning, that progressed a lot recently. These progress are also very useful, of course, in neurotechnology, because machine learning and deep learning are very relevant to interpret and decode the brain and neural activity. But the problem is we lack some specialists, and also the task force, that is the workforce that is dedicated to this implementation, is really slow compared to the mainstream technology. For example, Elon Musk, who drives Neuralink, they have at the moment 100 persons working on that. It's really small compared to everyone in Google, Siri, etc., all of these devices. So, for example, also to talk about the exoskeleton, they still use like a standard threshold. They do not treat the signal as efficiently as they could do. They are trying to implement this, but it's still slow and not available. So to have an overview of what can be useful still, despite all this problem, I will present you the concept of usability, and I will try to remind you the complexity of the nervous and locomotor system at the end. So usability, it's a concept that is standardized. It was mainly used for softwares, but it can be applied to other devices, and especially assistive devices. It's the extent to which a product can be used by specified users to achieve specified goals with effectiveness, efficiency, and satisfaction in a specified context of use. This part is also important. And this word is a set of methods to help you to criticize or maybe to buy a device to know if it's useful for you. So I would say that what is important to think of an assistive device is always to think to it relatively to other things. The problem also with what we saw before is that they do not give the comparison with what is already available, the wheelchair, the everything that you have at disposal. And so you compare with the other device, the state of the art, and with another use. What use is the best relevant for this device? I will give some examples. So even if this slide is not high-tech and not very exciting, still it's the state of the art, and it's mandatory to have it sometimes in front of us, because it's what we use daily, and we have to do better than that. And said like that, it looks simple. I think for an engineer coming in this field and see that, it's like, okay, we can do better. But the truth is, it's not so easy. So how to assess a device? We first have to monitor the reliability, the effectiveness. Like, is the device for a brain-computer interface? We ask, is the device is precise? Is it reliable? We ask the efficiency. What is the speed? What is the number of correct information per time unit? What is the mental workload needed to control the device? Because it's a hidden part, but for example, for the neurostimulation of the spinal cord, I was really impressed because when the patient trained, they were unable to do other things. Like they can only walk. So you imagine only walking but not talking to you someone, it's complicated for the social life. So the mental workload is important to monitor. There is also the satisfaction, which is a large part, but often not present in the paper, but very important for the acceptation of the device. Most of the devices that are bought are not used by the people. So you have to have a look on how the device is portable, storable. As we heard this morning, the need for sport device, you need a big garage to put everything, so it's really a problem. How is the social acceptance of the device? Can you use it independently? Is it comfortable, painful? What is its versatility? Can you use it for different tasks, or is it only for one task and you need to have one device for each task, etc. And of course the cost. And for each assessment you have tools, a questionnaire, and you can find standardized mean to assess this. So at the moment, is there any benefits offered by neurotechnology in terms of usability? With this framework, what do we find? Today, in the great majority of situations, no. There is a little benefit for some users, the ones that are totally paralyzed, with even no eye control, who cannot use of a device. Almost all studies, including the STAR system ones, are only proof of concept. My device works, but if you look at the detail, the trials are done with subjects that are healthy or not with a severe injury. For example, the exoskeleton, you see a lot of movies with healthy people inside the exoskeleton, so it's difficult to know how usable it is with a person, with a patient. There is no comparison with existing device, and the constraints are not possible in real life sometimes. The cost, the army of engineers around the device to make it work, that you cannot have even in hands when there is a specialist. You can have only one person, I guess, at a time. The limited duration of use, etc. So we wish longitudinal studies at home, in the community. We need to see my device works better than all the other assistive devices. It brings real benefits in usability and with a minimum amount of constraint to someone with also a detailed clinical status. To better know who can benefit from this device or this new technology in general. For example, for the neurostimulation, people who did not have any control of their arm called me to know if they could be implanted. Whereas for the training, we use crutches, we use device, and we require the arm. So it's important to know exactly who can benefit of the device. And sometimes, very often, it's really a very small population. So it's a lot of dozens of millions of euros for a very small population. It's very complicated to match this. And we also want when it doesn't work. That's why it's for this experience exactly in Clinatech. They put it in the paper, and it's very important to know, yes, for one patient where it succeeds, there is another that was implanted and explanted, hopefully with not too much damage, I hope. But it's important to know that.
Same goes for continence lab.
Same thing for the continence lab, exactly. And this is still informative for all the researchers and all the patients to know, yes, sometimes it does not work. And it's normal. It's like for any drugs, it does not work for everyone. So how to improve the matching between high-tech assistive device and end users' expectation? Because I still believe that it can be done. I hope so. So we have to match first, of course, the health conditions, the impairment, the personal factors, the value, activities, hobbies, motivation, expectation. I know we have a lot of sports people, so it's really a good motivation. There are environmental factors, how many professionals you have in your region or around your house to help you, how educated you are to technology in general, and the society acceptation also. I talk about it briefly, but it's not so easy to have a robotic arm. It can be frightening. For social interaction, it can be strange or badly accepted. And you could imagine also for things more intimate, like sexuality or other things, it's also a field that needs to be explored, how it is accepted. And also, just to say, there is not enough assistive device, adapted assistive device in this field in general. So here I took three examples. So actually, it's two neurotechnology: electrostimulation of the spinal cord, exoskeleton, and I compared it with the wheelchair. To give you an example, you can use it for what you want, FES, etc. So you can see for the effectiveness what can be done with a wheelchair. You can see that the weak part are the stairs, for example, or the normal restroom. I had one patient who told me I can't go at my friend's home anymore because their restroom are too small. But they can do some slope, uneven terrain, vehicle transfer. There are some compatibility options. For exoskeleton, the effectiveness at the moment is quite low. I did not find any positive point on this part. For electrostimulation of the spinal cord, there is a lot of interrogation because it could be used as an assistive device sometimes, maybe for some patient with some tuning, maybe we could achieve that, but we only had three patients at this moment, so we do not know. For the efficiency, what is the distance, the speed, and the mental workload? For the wheelchair, but it's the most efficient, obviously, between all the options. We can imagine progress in the other device, but it's not for today. And the satisfaction part, at the moment also, despite all the high tech in the other device, the wheelchair is still better. You can look at all the characteristics: portability, learnability, safety, installation time, aesthetic, social acceptance, independent use, maneuverability, comfort, pain. If you already used an exoskeleton, you know how it is difficult to improve this point. So maybe the strategy, at least one that is used also by default at the moment, but that could be a real strategy at the end, is to target some function. Like, for example, in BCI, the mainstream stakeholders are targeting the gamers, because they know these gamers will spend a lot of time trying to do a lot of function because they like that. Just they are a perfect pilot for that. I think in your domain, the sport is the same. It's the same thing. You spend a lot of time. You do not care if you spend a little time to install the device, because after, you know, during 1 hour, 2 hours, you will do your sport. So maybe you are also the good pilot for that, and it's a chance for Lyon that there is ants just next to the Lyon Research Center. The main requirements are just it's safe, of course, and it's sufficiently easy to use. For rehabilitation, it's a little bit more complicated because you need to do more different people. So you need to have a faster installation. You need rehabilitators prefer when you can do several tasks, because when you train only one task, it has Yves said before, you cannot transfer the ability to other tasks, so it's not useful in ecological setting. So you have more requirements. as an assistive device at home, still is the same game. You need more condition to use it, more portability, learnability, versatility. And if you want to use it in the community, outdoor, where you either you have a very specialized device that is used only for that, like the trike to go outside, or you need really the most adaptable device that exists. So for the sport, you use already some exoskeleton, and also for the rehabilitation. But for the other part, we need more research. The problem is for this device, it concerns quite a small population, spinal cord injury population. Let's hope that we can have a broader range of end users, like Elon Musk is targeting all the population at the end. He wants to implant everyone to merge every brain in one collective intelligence. So let's, I don't know hope for that or not. But still, he put a lot of money and it helped to develop new devices because he hopes that this investment will have some feedback after. So at the moment, the individual benefits are limited, but we hope that thanks to this small use in the sport and leisure community, after it will help to have the feedback and to create also this community between engineers and neuroscientists, patients, and to have finally something that you can bring at home with you. So maybe do you have some feedback on that? On will you see some errors? Or I don't know.
The only thing I would say is that another limitation that is significant is price.
Oh, sorry, I do not hear you well.
The only thing I would add to that was the that hadn't been already said is the cost to the end user. The end user can't afford the complex systems. I was shown an exoskeleton yesterday, which not only had the problems that you mentioned, it also costs €149,000.
That was the first point mentioned by the
it was the first point mentioned, yes, by Tom Shakespeare. And indeed, it's that's why I think the fact that you gather several people at the same place that can use the same device is a starting point for that, because you share the cost and you still have a little benefit, so the balance is a little bit more favorable, even if I know it's not so easy. Yeah, of course. But that's why in BCI we have a great hope in the gaming part, because they provided us already with some mainstream device that are not so efficient as a professional one, but still they can be used for demo and games. You put it very easily. It's only €300 compared to the €10,000 for the other device. So we begin to see some exchange between these different communities. So why is it so difficult to compensate an injury of the nervous system? Because the brain is much more complicated than our robot and our artificial intelligence. There is a functional segregation in the brain. So if you put a chip somewhere to interpret the motor command, you only have one part of the motor command. You do not have, for example, a cerebellum. You do not have the reorganization of the spinal cord. So some strategy appear when you do like in the Kinatec exoskeleton, or in exoskeleton in general, they try to have exoskeleton that have an auto balance. Like if you replace the reflex of the spinal cord and maybe a little bit the cerebellum, let's say. And you just have to send, I want to go there, and the exoskeleton will probably do the job at your place. So maybe this can work at one time. It's still unclear what will be the relative range between our control and the control of the device. The frontier is not fixed at the moment. Because with the the artificial intelligence, we can embed a lot of control now in the device. And also, until today, we still discover different biomarkers. For example, for the motor control, we used to use event-related synchronization to control the brain-computer interfaces, but it appears that it's not the best signal to control something motor system. Now we talk about beta burst. There are new signals that appears, and we better understand the different mechanism of the control, the motor control. And the more we try to modelize this motor control, the more we realize how complex it is. As Yves said before, it undercover that there is a lot of hidden abilities behind moving. Actually, you need to have intention, you need to have the proprioception feedback, you need to have this peripersonal space, like where you can act and where you cannot. You need to do the difference between the two. For a robot, it's not so easy to know what he can do or not. So roboticians are trying to implement that now, I saw. You need to be able to pay attention to the relevant part of the environment and to ignore the disturbing thing. It's modelized now for the autonomous, the drive and the car. So everything has to be built piece by piece to ensure that everything is safe. So motion is something that is finally very cognitive and not purely mechanistic. Still, we can have this kind of impressive robot. Maybe you already saw some movie of that. These robots, the Boston Dynamics ones, are really impressive. They can make saltos, they can jump, and on the video, they fell on their feet, so it's cool, but I guess before they had a lot of fall. And that's also one of the problems. So these robots, the cost is really like one little piece for the equilibrium is just more than the exoskeleton you took before. But still, it's a proof of concept that it's possible to do that. But if we think of it, you want to use that, if we put you in this as an exoskeleton, you cannot train it. It has to be perfect from the first step. It's like we cannot take the risk to hurt you or to kill you training the machine. So it had another layer of complexity. Everything has to be modelized before we put you in the machine. It's really a hard problem to solve, because it's not only mechanical constraint, it's also all the intentions, everything has to be prepared before you use it. So it's not for tomorrow. As a child, as you said before, we learn, as Piaget said, by essay trials and errors, and we cannot do that here. So we have to invent another way of preparing this device. So acting at all levels is... I forgot to put it in... in English, sorry, but we need to improve the technology. We need to improve the pluridisciplinarity, like we are doing today. We need to imply more the user at the beginning of the project, not only at the end when we need the patient to do the project. It's better to discuss from the beginning, so the user-centered design. And we hope for a neurotechnology in real life. And probably the core of all this limitation is still we need more advances in neuroscience, but hopefully the progress also in neurotechnology helps to make some remarkable advances also in neuroscience. And as Amin said, if you're interested by this topic, we are trying to make this nice event, the Hacking Rehab Lyon. Everyone is welcome. You just need to be motivated by helping a person with an impairment. And it's organized by the World Congress of Neuro Rehabilitation. We have a lot of help from engineering school and the medical school, etc. So the design school. So every background is welcome for this event. Thanks for your attention and if you have a question.
Thank you very much for that presentation.
Did you expect something like that? It's okay.
I had no idea what
to say. Okay, cool.
One of the things I wanted just to mention, again, it's a comment, it's not a question, is I'm always intrigued that people don't use the tongue more often. Because the tongue and mouth implants underneath, behind the teeth, mm-hmm. is extremely variable, and the tongue goes directly to the brain. It doesn't go through the spinal cord.
So for
tetraplegic or a very high level, the tongue could be a very useful tool. Second, voice command. What we've done recently, which I think is interesting, and publicitized a little bit, is using a lanthargic microphone, because that way you don't pick up outside interceptions, and you can whisper. Because I have a problem, I can't type, and I have to yell to my computer, and it doesn't understand me, and everyone else in the room hears what I'm writing, which I may not want them to, and they may not want to hear.
Yeah.
However, with the lanthargic microphone, I can whisper to my computer, and it picks it up better, and it's easier, and it's much more quiet and discreet.
Yeah, of course.
So there's small things like that that I think people, there's a lot to be done.
And
these lanthargic microphones have been around for years. Military, so and for snipers and whatnot. So I think you know, reflecting on those types of things, it's really important. Your message.
What you say. I think there is this. This background of ableist behind a lot of innovation, like putting so many money on walking versus so little on usable thing, I think it's not ethical for the long term.
That's already existent. Well, thank you again.
Thanks.